I declare the motion negatived. Debates with no legislative effect. The motion debate on abolishing the Mandatory Provident Fund offsetting mechanism. Members who wish to speak in the motion debate will please press the request to speak button. And I'll call upon the Honorable Wong Kwok-kin to speak and move the motion. Honorable Wong Kwok-kin. President, I move that the motion as printed on the agenda be passed. President, the MPF was launched in the end of 2000. Its effect as some kind of retirement protection has been criticized. We looked into the reasons why. The performance of the funds are varied and the fee charged is high. The offsetting mechanism has also damaged the retirement protection. It is the biggest culprit. In 2012, in his election platform, the CE promised to lower the accrued benefits of the employer being used to offset severance payments and long service payments gradually. But 4 years have passed. In treating the offsetting mechanism, the SARG has not achieved any progress at all. Did it not put its heart into doing it, or is it refusing to do it? I think the community knows too well. Abolishing the offsetting mechanism is for the purpose that MPF, the SP, and the LSP have different purposes. Let us talk about SP and LSP. If you have worked for 2 years, at least, when you are dismissed or suspended, the employer will pay the severance payment. As for long service payment, you have worked for 5 years. When the employee leaves the job because of health or age reasons, the employer will pay the long service payment. In simple terms, the purpose of SP and LSP are to relieve the short-term financial difficulties faced by employees because they leave a job. But the MPF is retirement protection. It is a mandatory contribution scheme based on employment to ensure that every employee will put aside some of the wages in order to save up for retirement. Some employees may not have a lot of savings. They may not save up for retirement. Now they have the MPF. They can save up some money for retirement. It can be seen that the purpose of SP and LSP is different from that of the MPF. Therefore, we should not use the accrued benefits derived from the employer's MPF contributions to offset SP and LSP. The two should not be mentioned together. Another reason for abolishing the offsetting mechanism is because it has eaten or eroded the wage money of employees, especially for the lower and middle income groups. In 2015, 47,300 employees were affected. 93% of their MPF accrued benefits were offset. In fact, in the catering, cleaning, security trades, very often the work contract is for 2 to 3 years and the employees are sent away. The offsetting mechanism will mean that the accrued benefits of MPF would be very much decreased, and it is in no way good for any retirement protection. Since the offsetting mechanism has not been abolished, employees' hard-earned money is eaten into, and the administration is and abetting the damage done to retirement protection. We are also asking the administration to comprehensively review the MPF to make sure that it continues to be effective so that it can really protect people after retirement. The fees charged have always said to be too high and the performance is bad. In 2016, the administration passed the core fund reform, trying to lower the management fees charged. But the average fund expense ratio is still 1.56%, which is much higher than the four countries that also have MPF, like Chile is 0.56%, England 1.19%, Australia 1.21%, Singapore a little higher, 1.41%. As the MPFA said, the authority needs to work harder to lower the fees because the fee level and is still a distance away from the general expectation of members. It would be the main thrust of their work to lower fees in future. The performance of the funds also varies, mainly because equity takes up 66% of the total assets of MPF, and it is very much affected by the volatility of external markets. Some business people think that abolishing the offsetting mechanism is like a monster, saying that it would cost the employers doubly, and they have to pay SP and LSP, and at the same time, the accrued benefits derived from employees' contributions. They also say offsetting or abolishing the mechanism would mean more financial burden for employers, and there will be a big change to the business environment of micro enterprises and SMEs. And they also said that the MPF was enacted only after much consultation. I'd like to state my position clearly here. Number one, in 2013, the offset amount was about $30 billion or $3 billion, and that only accounted for 0.37% of total emolument paid to employees. So there is a very small impact on cash flow. Dr. Lo Chi Kwong, an academic, said that abolishing the mechanism will only have a minimal effect on the finances of enterprises on an annual basis. So the businesses are making groundless statements when they say there will be more cost to be borne by employers. Number two, times have changed. The MPF offsetting has cost employees $29.2 billion, and it has eroded the retirement protection effect of the MPF. Therefore, to provide retirement protection for employees, there is a need to abolish the offsetting mechanism ASAP. News has it that recently the administration is inclined to cancel the LSP, and it is said that some unemployment insurance will take the place of SP. This is not acceptable to the FTU. As I said, the purpose of SP and LSP is to provide short-term relief to employees who lose their jobs. But if you cancel the SP and LSP, you are really putting the cart before the horse. You are diverting attention from the offsetting mechanism. And to propose to cancel LSP means the administration has given up its responsibility to protect the workers. And the employers might think that if they concede one step, they will be able to advance two steps. And there will be a negative impact on workers. I'm talking about using insurance to take the place of SP. That would mean that the administration will have to pay out of the public pocket to favor businesses. This is just too clear. Mr. President, the forces against the abolition are mainly psychological. I think the administration should play by example and be a good employer. First, you should act with the NCSC who are working for contractors. You should take the first step and abolish the offsetting mechanism for such workers. You should take the lead. The administration should not muddle its words in treating this abolition request. If the administration says no livelihood issues are small matters, then the offsetting mechanism is something so important for the employees. I hope you will respond quickly. Mr. Matthew Cheng, I hope you are here to really listen to the labor sector. I hope you will make a good start and abolish the offsetting mechanism first for your NCSC staff and play a demonstrative role for the businesses. This is all from me. I will make a reply later. I now propose the question to you, and that is that the motion moved by the Honorable Wong Kwok-kin be passed. 6 members will move amendments to this motion. This council will now proceed to a joint debate on the motion and the 6 amendments. I will call upon members who move the amendments to speak in the following order: Jimmy Ng, En Chang, Andrew Wen, Fernando Zheng, Lau Siu-lai, and Michael Tian. But they may not move their amendments at this stage. Honorable Jimmy Ng. Thank you, President. I'd like to thank our colleague for moving this motion so we can express our views as businesses. The businesses always object that before we have a comprehensive review. Sorry, please move up the microphone.
Thank you, lecturer.
Why don't I hold it in my hands? The businesses always object that before we have a comprehensive review of all employee protection and social security systems, and then we abolish the offsetting mechanism. Let us always remember what the purposes of all these schemes are. Let us review. Mr. Jimmy Ng, please clip the mic on your lapel. No, it falls down.
Okay. 好. 其中涉及兩個概念.
There are 2 concepts. The first one has to do with SP and LSP. In 1968, when the Employment Ordinance was enacted, the community had a lot of dispute about its details, including severance payment and retirement arrangements. And in the end, in 1974 and 1986, the administration enacted SP and LSP. To say that it is inappropriate for employers to pay double, this has been time-honored. The second concept has to do with the MPF. We all know that both sides have to make contributions. The original idea is to protect workers' retirement. Since SP and LSP have the same purpose as MPF, and that is to protect workers' retirement, if both go in parallel, it is double burden for employers, but double benefit for employees. That is why in 1995, when the MPFO was enacted, the administration promised that the offsetting mechanism will stay, so employers did not have to pay double. In other words, the relationship between the SP and LSP and MPF, well, they overlap. They have the same function as protection for retirement. The offsetting mechanism balances the interests of the two sides, and it is a consensus reached after in-depth studies by the society. The upper limit for SP and LSP is $390,000, and there is no condition that is ripe for offsetting the payment. Over 90% of businesses in Hong Kong are SMEs. Just imagine, if there is operating difficulty, employers would like to wind up the business or they want to retire, they still have to pay large amounts of SP and LSP. It's so difficult for employers. It is not that every company in Hong Kong is a limited company. There are many unlimited companies in Hong Kong. In other words, if an employer wants to retire or he wants to wind up his business, then to unlimited companies, they may have to go bankrupt because the employer has no money to pay SP or LSP. Some people may say the purpose of MPF is to help employees save up for retirement, and SP and LSP are for meeting financial needs in the short term. But I beg to differ. One, I cannot see the difference between the two. Whether it's SP, LSP or MPF, employers play their part. There may be different purposes, but then it's not right for employers having to pay double. Even if the two are different, does it mean the employer has to pick up the tab for retirement protection and unemployment protection? Well, I'd like to say if it is a retirement protection scheme, then the administration should play a bigger role in Social Security. We must admit that Social Security is quite good. We have four pillars. One, the Social Security system, including OALA, OAA and CSSA. Two, MPF. Three, savings of employees. And four, public services and family support. But in fact, there can be more unemployment protection. They can apply for CSSA now, but the procedure is very complicated, so their short-term needs may not be met. As for the employee retraining schemes and the self-reliant security schemes, they cannot meet short-term needs. The businesses think that there can be a dedicated severance payment scheme set up by government, and also there can be a short-term insurance paid for unemployment, so employees can tie over maybe 2-3 months when they are unemployed. I think all these are very constructive and we should look at them rationally. Hong Kong should continue to go for a multiple pillar arrangement so as to make sure there will be a series of public services so that there will be a sustainable, affordable, and stable retirement protection scheme. We understand the administration completed consultation on retirement protection in June, and it said that by early next year, there will be the release of the findings. We hope the administration will make an in-depth quantitative study about the offsetting mechanism and its abolition on employees, employers, on society and our economy. If the administration is happy to take up more responsibility, I think we can help to resolve the present disputes. In other words, when a retirement protection policy is launched, there must be more consideration about unemployment protection and the offsetting mechanism. Certainly, the businesses are not calcified in their thoughts. Anything that can help employees in unemployment and have a better life, we are very happy to look into them. But if the administration is bent on abolishing the offsetting mechanism, then before the law comes into effect, if there are accrued benefits already in MPF accounts, should there be a retrospective effect? Apart from the businesses, I think the administration and the labor sector should also play a role. Now, how much should they be responsible for? Let us think about all these issues. Let us think about these practical issues. And don't just shout the slogan, abolish the offsetting mechanism. Lastly, I'd like to emphasize that while you review the MPF, you should also review all social security systems to make sure that public resources are used fairly. I speak in objection to the motion. Thank you.
Dr. An Cheng. Thank you. President, a lot of contributions by employees have been eroded because of the offsetting mechanism. Recently, an offsetting report was published. We can see the problem is very serious. More than 40,000 employees are affected by the offsetting mechanism, and more than 90% of the contributions have been offsetted. For those with an income of less than $10,000, a lot of them have nothing left in their MPF accounts. So we can see that the lower the income of employees, the more they are affected by the offsetting arrangement. The creation of the Mandatory Provident Fund served to protect employees when they retire, but with the offsetting arrangement, everything has been washed away. So where is the protection? Severance payments were introduced in 1974. At that time, some companies made dismissals suddenly, and as such, the idea of severance payments were introduced. In 1986, the government considered the fact that some employees have worked in the same company for decades, and for some reason, the company or boss no longer needs them. Staring at unemployment, they had nothing. They had no retirement protection at all. That's why long service payments, or LSP, were introduced, and it was a good move. In 1992, the vocational retirement ordinance was enacted, followed by the MPF ordinance. So we might be talking about a lot of things. We have severance payments, LSP, MPF, etc. But at the end of the day, we are still talking about the same pool of money. The matter is, are you going to make withdrawals sooner or later? If a company is driven out of business, then you would get your payment sooner. If you withdraw sooner, they might be SPs, but if you wait longer, that would be LSP. And if you've never made any withdrawals, eventually the sum of money you get would be the MPF. But now all the money has been eroded. So where is the retirement protection? The original intention was lost. We find it necessary to review LSP, SP, and MPF in a holistic manner. You have to consider how we can strike a balance. At the end, you have to improve the retirement protection of employees. So after you add up the figures, the sum should not be lesser. And I think this would be unacceptable for both employees and businesses. So we need a comprehensive study. This February, the DAB held a roundtable meeting on the MPF offsetting arrangement. We met some scholars, labor unions, etc. We had a frank exchange. We found out more about each other's views, and our collective goal was to come up with a solution to provide better retirement protection for employees. In the meeting, we summarized certain points. First of all, we agree that our community needs a sustainable and open communication platform. The government has an active role to play, or even they should host such meetings. We hope that for the MPF offsetting mechanism, we are talking about SP, LSP, and MPF. We should adopt a tiered and gradual method. For SP, would we consider setting up an unemployment fund to replace SP? As long as we can sit down together and communicate with each other, or come together for lobbying, as long as we are devoted to the public, nothing could get in the way. The government should make active arrangements, and they should consider shouldering part of the financial burden. As Mrs. Carrie Lam once said, on the cancellation of MPF offsetting, the government has a firm stance, and they hope that it can be done. We believe that as long as the government is devoted, it would happen. As long as the government can shoulder some financial burden, as long as we can get the government on board, we believe that the government would be solved. Apart from canceling the MPF offsetting, it's equally necessary to review the MPF regime. The DAB has advocated to expand the types of products under MPF schemes. For example, FX-linked products or inflation-linked guaranteed funds. This would offer more protection to employees and ensure stable income for them. No one is expecting to receive a lot of money through this scheme, but at least we should be able to get something. The DAB also suggests studying the viability of full portability in MPF schemes. This should be improved. Right now, we have more than 20,000 employees, but in our MPF accounts, we have more than 7 million bodies. I think we should study how we can reduce our administrative costs. On Mr. Jimmy Ng's amendment, he's strongly against the motion, and the DAB would not accept his view. Dr. Fernando Cheung condemned the chief executive. He is out of the topic, and he's just exploiting the situation. We would vote him down as well. As for other suggestions, some are rather satisfactory, but some we should be more open. We should not be fixed by certain constraints, and so I speak. Thank you.
Mr. Andrew Wen.
President, I'm sure many members of the public would remember that in 2012, when Siu-lai Leung ran in a CE race, he said that nothing was too trivial for him to look after when it comes to people's livelihood. And then he said that with a folding chair, a notepad, and a pen, he would always he would be all ears to listen to people's grievances. But what has he done in the 4 years since he was elected? Has he gone out there to meet the people with his pen and folding chair and notepad? Yes, recently, in the last few days, perhaps it's because his term is drawing to an end and it's time for his campaign again. In the past 4 years, there is precious little to mention when it comes to Siu-lai Leung's labor policies. Take SMW as an example. Statutory minimum wage is subject to review on a biannual basis. As we all know, inflation is high in Hong Kong, and with only few dollars increase every 2 years, how can we catch up with inflation? Every time a new SMW is affected, the rise would be offset or eroded by inflation. Traffic subsidies, well, there's been no increase since 2010. Starting from 2011, we've seen more than 20% rise in MTR fares. Has there ever been any review in the WITSS? And Siu-lai Leung said in his manifesto that he was going to legislate on standard working hours. Eventually, we only have contract working hours. Public consultations after public consultations, and we ended up having only this contract working hour. So this is entirely against his original manifesto. Coming back to the subject of this debate, abolition of the offset mechanism. Since the establishment of MPF, there's been many rounds of debate. As early back as 2012, Siu-lai Leung proposed the abolition of the offset mechanism. I think many people, employees included, had a lot of hopes for him. All right, a subcommittee was set up in this council. Government officials came here to meet with us 4 times. Other than that, what has the administration done? What homework has it done? I look forward to a reply from the administration. We support the direction of Mr. Wong Kwok-kin's original motion. I believe all members who represent the labor sector and the public at large would support FTU's proposal to ask Siu-lai Leung to honor his campaign undertaking. DP supports the abolition of the offset mechanism, and therefore we support Mr. Wong Kwok-kin's original motion regarding Dr. Fernando Cheung, Mr. Cheng, Dr. NJ, and Ms. Lau Siu-lai's amendments. In the long term, they will seek to cancel the offset arrangement. Therefore, we support it. As for Mr. Michael Tian's amendment, he has left the offsetting arrangements for LSP, although he has done away with offsetting arrangement for severance payment, and therefore we cannot support his amendment. The purpose of setting up the MPF is clear to all. We want employers and employees to contribute to the to a good long-term saving system for retirement, so that employees can be well provided for after retirement. This is the original intention of the MPF. It is also a retirement system. Mr. Yip Shui Kwan in 2002, in a motion to review the MPF, said to ensure that MPF account holders could receive real cash, they could reap the fruits of their hard work, that would be good. But in reality, we only see savings being eroded by administrative costs. which are still very high, and investment return is also rather poor. And because of the offset mechanism, very often employees don't get enough to support them in their twilight years, and this is entirely against the original intention of the MPF system. The offsetting mechanism contradicts the MPF. For severance pay, it is the expenses of a company paid to say goodbye to the employees, and this is an obligation of the company. For MPF, as we all know, the purpose of an MPF is to provide for the an employee's retirement. No matter what you call it, when an employee retires after working for decades, he should be entitled to savings to keep him alive. So what you call it doesn't matter. The important thing is to have a mechanism, and this offsetting arrangements have deprived our employees of this benefit because of this loophole in the system. And for long service payment, by the same token, if an employee has served a company for with many good years of service, if in return he only gets his own contributions, it sounds ridiculous. In between 2001 and 2007, close to $29 billion have been lost in LSP or in the offsetting arrangements. These are the savings of employees, and this has diluted the effect of the system. For grassroots employees, how can they be well provided for in their twilight years? In between 2012 and 2014, 26% to 30% of the money withdrawn for LSP, money withdrawn was for long service payment. If we spend this $29 million lost in offset arrangement and put them back into the pockets of employees so that they can spend that after the retirement, you can imagine how much more protection they can obtain. And in the community, we've seen many cases. Many workers are unhappy with the offsetting mechanism, and they are casual workers, grassroots workers. I think the most disastrous area is perhaps the catering industry. The secretary should know very well that, I don't know whether it is a coincidence, many restaurants would close after operating for a few years, and then the company reorganize and then reopen again. As we all know, because of the system in Hong Kong, the same person may not be the boss of the employees. So they may use some money in the MPF accounts to fulfill their obligations as employers. And these employees may only have a service period of a few years. So after many rounds of offsetting, workers may end up having only $100 or $80,000 in cash after serving for decades. How are they expected to survive with that amount of money? And eventually, it will be public funds used to support them, because these employees will have to rely on Social Security. So if you allow unscrupulous employers to evade their responsibility, at the end of the day, you have to use public money to fill the gap, and this is unreasonable. A veteran labor representative said that Siu-lai deliberately stalled so that this matter could be left towards the close of this term, and then it can be bargaining chips for his re-election. So he claimed that with a folding chair, a notepad, and a pen, he could then work for the community. In fact, his promises were empty and vague. Lastly, I'd like to say I support the direction of the original motion. I'd also like to move an amendment. Thank you.
Dr. Fernando Zhang, President. I was listening to Mr. Chimmy Ng. He said he could not distinguish the SP or LSP from the MPF. He said there was no difference in their purposes. To him, offsetting is just about the employer's payments. As long as the employers are paying, the payment should be limited. And if there is offsetting or abolishing of the offsetting mechanism, then it's not right. Just let us look at the website of the MPFA. It talks about the background, that it is for retirement protection, and more so because of the aging of the population. And MPF on its own website says that whether it be the three pillars or five pillars of the World Bank, MPF is the second pillar, and that is a mandatory contribution scheme managed by the private sector. This is very clear. This is about retirement protection. When someone reaches retirement age, which is 65 now, then you can get this sum of money. So under MPF, employees cannot get the accrued benefits before they reach retirement age. But the employers can, as long as the business is wound up. Once an employee is dismissed, the employer can get the money. This is so ridiculous. Employees also make contributions. The objective is, if Mr. Jimmy Ng asks us to look back at the purpose, then it is retirement protection. That is why employees cannot get the money, but not so for employers. This is impossible. There is a contradiction of purposes. The business sector always says this arrangement has been for a long time like this. And in fact, before the MPF, the employment ordinance allows businesses to create their own retirement schemes. And those can also be offset by the SP and LSP. That is correct. That's history. Why was that allowed? It is because we did not have a community-wide and government-mandated retirement system or pillar. The business sector was encouraged to voluntarily set up some kind of retirement protection for employees. That is why there is this offsetting mechanism. But now it's different. We have enacted laws to mandate all employers and employees to follow one system, and that is the MPF. It is mandatory, and it is not done by way of encouragement. So there is now a contradiction, and so there should be the abolition of the mechanism. I think the concepts are clear. They are clear to the administration. Ms. N. Chang says, we are taking advantage. What kind of advantage are we taking? Siu-lai Leung said in his election platform, said this under population and human resources, point 16, and I quote, to gradually decrease the offsetting of SP and LSP by employers' contributions to MPF. That is what Siu-lai Leung said, to gradually reduce the ratio of offsetting. In other words, by and by, offsetting will be eventually abolished. He talked about a gradual approach. It's all right. Go for it gradually. It doesn't matter. Just give us a timetable and a roadmap. Siu-lai Leung's five-year term has only half a year left. He is not delivering what he promised. He should be reprimanded. This is very important protection for employees. We know we started in the wrong manner. I was not a member of the LegCo then, but I also objected having the MPF. And all these years, how much has been offset? Over 40,000 employees were affected, and over 90% of their employers' contributions have been offset, meaning about $30 billion. How many employees became unemployed? They might have a new contract, they might go to a different employer, and so they lost their retirement protection. The media quoted many of these examples in the past 10 years. This has been done, and some cleaners may go from one company to another, and in fact, the administration plays the lead. Your LCSD, your HD, your FEHD, you contract out cleaning and security services, and you change contractors every 2 or 3 years. Once that is done, the offsetting is done, and that is why the retirement protection has been lost. When the employee reaches the age of 65, but who has worked casual jobs all these years, they would only have like $20,000 to $30,000 in the savings account because most of the employer's MPF contributions have been offset. They would be in their 60s and they are not employable. How do you expect them to lead a dignified retirement life when they have only $30,000 in their bank? Let us talk reason. Starting from 2003, every year over 1 billion was offset, and 2011 over 2 billion, and 2014 over 3 billion. It's a cumulative sum. The most conservative economics professors like Wong Yu Chim will tell you that the MPF is mandatory and employers should not be able to offset the payments. And he even said that MPF reform should not be influenced or constrained by stakeholders like banks and employers. It's very seldom that he has so much sense. And I believe he has made a most remarkable point. And also Mr. Andy Kwan, who is also a relatively conservative economic professor. He says the two kinds of contributions are totally different and they should not be mixed together. This is so clear. This comes from the most conservative economic professors. And when Siu-lai Leung assumed the post, he said he would do it, but he had dragged his feet. What does he want to do now? Why can't he make concrete arrangements to effect this? Of course, some people say there can be a new fund and we can even consider unemployment insurance. Mr. President, if we go for some kind of social insurance to protect employees who become unemployed or who are sick or aged, so they become poor, so they have financial needs, we will go for it. Social insurance, we think, is some kind of good protection against risks, but these can in no way replace our request to abolish the offsetting mechanism. The MPF should retain its function of retirement protection, but to be quite frank with you, in the ideal situation, I believe the entire MPF system should be abolished because it shortchanges us, the return is too low, the management fee is too high, but at least now there should be the abolition of the offsetting mechanism so that we set things right away. So employees who work short contracts will, after 10 odd years of work, will not be deprived of dignified retirement.
Ms. Lau Siu-lai. Today in our motion debate to cancel the offsetting mechanism, we have mixed feelings. We have spent a lot of time to see how the policy can better meet the public needs. This should be our responsibility, and this is a social need. There shouldn't be any conflicts, but the situation now is unique. The intention of the MPF is to provide retirement protection. We should be canceling the offsetting mechanism. However, you can see that the government is playing tricks and they do not want to right the wrong. We have to start with the MPF's history. If we want to know why the current calls for cancellation of the arrangement is so contentious, the MPF was originally a tool to relieve the pressure due to calls for retirement protection. The HKU commissioned Mrs. Williams to study Hong Kong's retirement protection options. The conclusion was that relying on family was not enough. We needed comprehensive retirement protection. One of the government's working groups also agreed that the price of not having retirement protection in place is very high, and the impacts would be more and more pronounced. 40 years on, we still have no retirement protection. The so-called price 40 years ago is to have 300,000 poor elderly people. We have scavengers everywhere, and they have to collect a lot of recyclables before they can afford to buy some bread. The government started the work, but it had no commitment. It only rolled out the schemes like OALA, disability allowance, etc. Nonetheless, the NGOs have started certain initiatives, and a central MPF fund or proposal was created, and the government carried out consultation on annuities and citizens aged 65 or above would be paid, and the employee and employer would be paid 1.5% each, and the government would inject $10 billion as a seed fund. This is very similar to our suggested universal retirement protection proposal. If it had come true, we won't have to worry about it today. We want to improve retirement protection so that everyone can benefit. Under the pressure of the socialist China, the government said such proposals are problematic, and such proposals are revoked. And in 1993, the government rolled out an even more conservative plan, which is the MPF plan we are seeing now, run by private operators. And together with the offsetting arrangement, we are at this situation today. The business was unanimously against annuities. They supported MPF. They did not want to shoulder the burden of retirement protection. So Mr. Jimmy Ng moved an amendment, and this spirit is completely against the intention of the original motion. He removed the words that seriously eroded the hard-earned money of wage earners and directly affected their retirement protection. In the business world, they businesses benefit from the offsetting arrangement. Unscrupulous employers have eroded $3.35 billion in total, and on average, each employer has eroded $233,000. And they said the business environment of Hong Kong is affected. But the cumulative wage increases of these companies are far higher than $233,000, and they never complained. And they are all reluctant to pay severance payments, and they say that such payments would affect their businesses. First of all, I want to make some clarifications. MPF is a form of retirement payment, and the MPF is to provide provisions, to make provisions for retirement protection. So it's a form of retirement protection. The worst part of the system is the offsetting mechanism. The offsetting arrangement eroded the benefits of many of the hard-earned money of employees. They mix up labor protection and retirement protection, and the employers can get away with it, and they are unwilling to shoulder the responsibility, and payments are often deducted. For the boss, these are just meaningful figures. With another zero or one less zero, it wouldn't make much difference. They are making a lot anyway. However, for many workers, these benefits are crucial. Those would decide whether they can live a comfortable life. In case of layoffs, dismissals, etc., SP would be made, and the workers would still have some income after being dismissed, and their financial burden can be alleviated. Long service payment served to supplement SP, and compensation would be made for employees with a continuous service at the same company for 5 years. So obviously these payments are not savings in nature or retirement protection. Starting from the middle of next year, the government has been spreading the sentiments. At the end of last month, Carrie Lam and Matthew Cheung soft lobbied through the FTU on the cancellation of SP and LSP. They sacrificed the benefits of employees to protect these conglomerates. The government said by removing SP and LSP, they would introduce an unemployment insurance aid. Such payments come from taxes rather than the conglomerates. When you look at the amendments moved by Jimmy Ng and Michael Tian, you can see how annoying these businessmen are. We must defend the rights of employees, and we have to understand the concept of retirement protection and come up with a universal retirement scheme to protect our elderly people. Our grassroots contributed a lot to our economy, but they lack protection. The poverty gap is getting worse. I hope the businessmen and entrepreneurs face up to your social responsibility and act for the benefit of the whole Hong Kong. Thank you.
Mr. Michael Tian. President, before I start, let me declare interest. I'm the boss of a government group and also member of the Poverty on Commission on Poverty. Because I wear two hats, I believe I can tackle this highly controversial issue from two perspectives. I'm grateful to Mr. WONG Kwok-kin for moving this motion. My amendment seeks to provide you with my own solution of the problem so that we can find a way out for the whole issue. Mrs. Carrie Lam said that the MPF system is one of the three mountains in the way of Hong Kong's development. I cannot agree more. The MPF system is indeed a very important issue, and I appreciate the government's attitude. They have attached significance to this matter. Two secretaries are present, namely the SLW and FSST. I hope they can learn from our collective wisdom so that we can have policies that can benefit the whole community. Going back to the MPF system, it is a well-intentioned one to provide for people's retirement. And there was a protracted debate before the establishment. There was prolonged negotiations between the employers and also the government. Even before we have the MPF, we already had the also scheme. The contributions from occupational retirement scheme, also schemes, were allowed to be used to offset severance payments and long service payment. And then in 1995, the LegCo then endorsed the MPFS ordinance. And the long-standing offsetting arrangements have been extended into the system. And when the bill was drafted, there were strong calls from the labor sector against the extension of the offsetting mechanism to the new system. And then in 2000, the MPF system was formally launched and the offsetting arrangement was in place. There would be offsetting of employers' contributions for service payment and long service payments. It can be sure that without this compromise, there was no way the MPF system could be established in the first place. And I think this is in line with what I propose in my amendment. I ask the administration to abolish the arrangement of offsetting severance paid with MPF contributions under the MPF ASAP, but retain the arrangements of offsetting long service payment with MPF contributions, and there should be insurance taken out, and the government should pay for the premium. People may say that, well, I won't be able to please any party because I am on the side of the government. In fact, I'm trying to reason with you. I'm not siding with any particular party. The offsetting arrangement is here because many scholars back then agreed that LSP had a retirement protection element, so there was overlapping in their purposes. But in fact, looking back, you for severance payment, you cannot give the same argument because a company has to wind up because of poor operation or poor management by the company. And when an employee is sacked, he will be out of job for a while, and there must be some form of protection for him. So how can it is impossible that we can have something that please both parties. They are bound to be some pros and cons. Perhaps the way out is a little bit give and take from both parties. Perhaps we are just cheating ourselves if we can have a system that please both parties. Last year, the business sector and the labor sector had the discussion of offsetting the of cancelling the offsetting arrangement. There was proposal to abolish the offsetting arrangement for LSP but not SP, And the FTU said that it maintained an open mind. And Mr. Professor Nelson Chow of Hong Kong, you said that from a justice point of view, the offsetting arrangement for severance payments should be abolished. I think it's crystal clear to everyone that with a little bit give and take, this is the way to resolve the problem. The more stubborn we are, the more difficult it will be to untie the knot. So I know I may offend somebody, but I have mustered my courage to say something that may not be pleasing to the ears of some here. All right, I agree that SP offset arrangements should be removed. However, there should be unemployment insurance taken out by the employees when the company has financial problem, or if a company wants to reorganize or to wind up, and if employees are sacked or dismissed, they will face immediate financial difficulties. Earlier this year, my staff reflected to me in my company, because at some strategic changes in the company, some posts were abolished. I've no choice, because the government has refused to do anything, and we have fewer individual visitors from the mainland, and our business turnover has been dropping for more than 20 months in a row, so there was nothing I could do. And I was told by a senior executive that our staff would suffer if they were dismissed. So I made the immediate decision to cancel the offsetting arrangements for SP. I urge the administration to consider this. Keep the offsetting mechanism for LSP, abolish the SP offsetting arrangements, but keep the LSP to help employees to tide over the difficult period. It's not easy for an employer to pay both. So I hope the government can help us to break this stalemate with huge reserves the government has. I believe he's capable of doing this. Professor Nelson Chow asked for removing the offsetting arrangement. I am asking for cancelling of LSP offsetting, but keeping the SP. Because even if we have the LSP offsetting arrangement, there will still be balance in the contribution or the benefits to support employees' retirement. I hope I can get the support of employers. It is hard to please all parties. I think I'm just taking middle-of-the-road approach. I have this cardinal doctrine in business. You must achieve a win-win situation. You cannot conclude a business deal if you want only one side to win. Whether you represent the labor part, the labor sector, or the employees, I think you should use your wisdom to resolve these problems. Please spend some time to think about my proposal. Otherwise, we have no choice but to continue this bickering. If we insist, if both sides insist that over my dead body, then how many more years do we have to wait? Do we have to revisit this in the next C election? And will the C elect honor its undertaking? Do we have to wait many, many years more? Thank you.
Secretary for Labor and Welfare, I would like to thank Mr. Wong Kwok-kin for moving the motion, as well as six members, Jimmy Ng, En Chang, Andrew Wen, Fernando Cheng, Lau Siu-lai, and Michael Tian, for moving amendments. This is a valuable chance to take in comments at the new term of LETCO, especially new members on this highly complicated and controversial issue. First of all, I'd like to highlight the protections under the Employment Ordinance for severance payment and long service payment and the MPF offsetting arrangement. The SPs were introduced in 1974 under the Employment Ordinance to provide compensation for laid-off employees to alleviate their financial burdens due to a loss of jobs. Subsequently, since compared with dismissed employees who are laid off, who have served the same employee for many years, receive very different compensations in the law, and older employees often find it hard to find a new job after being dismissed. And since 1986, LSP was introduced under the EO to provide compensation. Subsequently, multiple revisions were made to the LSP, and under different cases, compensations will be provided. When introducing SP and LSP, an offsetting arrangement was put in place to allow employers to use the contributions or remuneration paid to employees to offset LSP and SP expenses. The MPF ordinance was enacted in the year 2000. The intention of the legislation is to set up a mandatory provident scheme to provide retirement protection or benefits to employees when rolling out the scheme in order to avoid the need for employers to make double expenditures. The MPF ordinance allow employees to use accrued benefits from employers' contributions for its employees towards MPF schemes in offsetting the SPs and LSPs pay to employees. This is known as the offsetting arrangement. Right now, MPF covers more than 2.5 million employees, and it's a key pillar of the four pillars in Hong Kong's retirement protection system. The three other pillars include a social security program paid for by public money, voluntary retirement savings insurance, and public service family support and personal assets. With population aging, the amount of resources the government put in to elderly services has increased. In 2016 to 17, the government spent a total of $67.3 billion on elderly services, social security, and healthcare, or 20% of the government's recurrent spendings. This shows the government's commitment towards the elderly. There are views from the community that we should strengthen the retirement protection function of MPF as the second pillar of Hong Kong's retirement protection system. If the offsetting arrangement is allowed to exist, on the long run, MPF's retirement protection function would be jeopardized. In fact, we have had split views in the community towards the offsetting arrangement. The labor sector is concerned that the offsetting arrangement would affect the accrued benefits within the MPF schemes under employers' contributions, and they strongly request to cancel the arrangement, and then they want to enhance employees' retirement protection. On the same time, chambers, employee organizations, and businesses are generally against it because it would affect the burden, it would increase the burden of employers. If we look at the figures of SP and LSP payments offsetted under MPF, we would agree that this issue must be tackled in 2015. $3 billion was withdrawn for employers' mandatory contributions to MPF involving $45,300. On average, the amounts of SP and LSP offsetted for each employee was $58.6 and $105,600. Since MPF was introduced, the total amounts of funds withdrawn due to offsetting is near $30 billion. Compared with the $600 billion total asset value of MPF, the withdrawn value is only 5%. However, for employees affected by the offsetting arrangement, these amounts are already a lot for them. And for low-income employees, they are more seriously affected by the offsetting. This is certainly not ideal for all employees. This must be dealt with. As our population continues to age, retirement protection is imminent. The Commission on Poverty launched a six-month public consultation since the beginning of last year on retirement protection on strengthening the functions of different retirement protection pillars, including MPF and the offsetting arrangement, and the government consulted the public. I want to stress that this public engagement on the offsetting arrangement was proposed by the current term administration, and it shows the government's commitment in tackling this long-standing problem. We all know that MPF offsetting is a complicated and contentious issue. When conducting public engagement, the Commission on Poverty has said that we cannot underestimate the complexity of this issue, and they also understand employers' concerns towards rising costs. The Commission also stressed that the offsetting arrangement is not about simply to a retention or dismissal. If we are to cancel the offsetting arrangement, we must allow ample discussion in the society on when and how it would be implemented, and we must find a way acceptable by both employers and employees. We have to strike a balance between employers' and employees' rights. We hope that both sides would be understanding towards each other and be pragmatic. After the consultation completed in June this year, the government is studying the collective views. President, on Mr. Wong Kwok-kin's motion, I speak on the offsetting arrangement of SBN LSP. Myself and the Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury will further respond after taking in comments from members. Thank you.
Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury. President, the MPF system, as mentioned by the SLW, has been in place for 16 years since its inauguration in 2000. And the government has launched from time to time improvement measures to enhance the effect of MPF system in retirement protection and to enhance retirement protection for our retirees. This is one element of retirement protection system, and the second pillar in the system, retirement protection system advocated by the World Bank. Compared with before the establishment of the system, only one-third of the workforce was covered by any form of retirement protection. But since the introduction of MPF system, over 85% of workforce, equivalent to 3.2% of our 3.2 million of our employers, self-employed persons, are covered by different levels of retirement protection. As at the 30th of August 2016, contributions plus investment returns have grown to $644.6 billion. After deducting fees and charges, since the establishment of the system, investment returns have reached $133.6 billion, and that is the analyzed internal return deducting fees and charges are now 3.2%, and this is well over the CPI index growth during the same period. Since the SLW has briefed members on the public consultation of our retirement protection and the way forward for the offsetting arrangement, I'll focus on what the government has done to improve the MPF system. In the past 15 years, the government and the MPFS authority has launched a number of measures to strengthen our retirement protection, this particular pillar for our employees, and this includes the employee choice arrangement, enhancing flexibility in withdrawal of accrued benefits, enhancing regulation in marketing and promotion, enhanced protection for scheme members, and also a series of measures to lower fees and charges. We've also stepped up the requirement on fee disclosure. We asked the industry to launch a low fee funds. We encourage and facilitate the consolidation of schemes, constituent funds, and personal accounts. On our website, we have a list to compare the fees and performance of different trustees and also funds. Since the implementation of the employee choice arrangement, over half of the constituent funds have lowered the administration commission fees and charges. But 40% of them are now low fees funds, and with fees less than 1%, or with the actual expenses fund ratio less than 1.3%. And the fund expense ratio has dropped from 2.1% in 2007 to 1.56 to now a reduction of over 25%. One of the most important improvement measures recently is to introduce a default investment strategy with fee controlled. The relevant MPFS Amendment Bill 26 was passed in last May, and the MPF authority and the industry are now preparing for the early implementation of the DIS. Just on the 14th of October, we gazetted the commencement notice of the amendment notice, which will be the 1st of April 2017. Approved trustees will have to provide a highly standardized DIS with fee caps for each MPF scheme for all scheme members to choose from. For scheme members that have not made a choice, their accrued benefits will be invested according to the DIS. And the fee caps include a 0.7% of administrative fees and also a cap of 0.2% in the actual expenses.
You see, the default investment scheme directly responds to the issue of high fee and difficult to make choices. It is an important step to improve the scheme. Since the enactment of the amendment ordinance, we have seen positive effect arising from the amendments. As of since May this year, 45 constituent funds have reduced their fees, and 8 schemes have been consolidated. We hope that since its implementation on the 1st of April, the DIS would provide some indication to reduce the fees and charges. President, having listened to members' views, I will make a consolidated reply, and the administration and MPFA staff will, in implementing improvements, have regard to members' valuable comments. Thank you very much. Mr. Tommy Chow. President, regarding Mr. Wong Kwok-kin's amendment to remove the offsetting arrangement for SP and LSP, as a representative of the catering industry, I like to raise some strong objection. The trade told me a lot about the offsetting arrangement regarding SP and LSP, and also the standard working hours. They said I should play a gatekeeping role here in this council to make sure that they will not slip past this particular arrangement.
Well,
we have to know that as far as the catering industry is concerned, expenses on staff pay have increased, and it accounts for over 30% of our turnover. So as I said just now, it accounts for over 30% of our turnover. And this is according to government statistics. This is not just coming from me off the cuff. This is the trend that we have observed over the past years. So for labor-intensive industries such as the catering industry, abolishing the offsetting mechanism will have a great impact. Together with the other problems such as high rental and inflation, if the MPF offsetting mechanism is abolished, then the industry will have to prepare itself by paying extra for the severance payment and long service payment. And I've been told by those in my industry that they're already struggling. So abolishing the MPF offsetting mechanism is putting their business at stake. And the amount that have to be reserved for those payments will exceed the $3 billion used in the offsetting process by the MPF authority. And this will, of course, deal a great blow to the Hong Kong economy, which is on decline. For enterprises in Hong Kong, as far as enterprises in the catering industry, their competitiveness is being eroded, and the government therefore should not introduce measures to increase their business costs, because enterprises may fold up as a result, and people may lose their jobs. For the offsetting mechanism, I want to emphasize that the government conducted a thorough consultation when it was first introduced, and it was also the consensus forged. At that time, many employers' associations and chambers of commerce agreed to the offsetting to the MPF, because there is the offsetting mechanism as well. The employment ordinance allows employers to use the long service payment contribution to offset severance severance payments. With the introduction of MPF, many enterprises switched from provident funds to the MPF because, according to the government, there would still be the offsetting mechanism. So when the labor sector suggests that the MPF offsetting mechanism is eating away the take-home pay of employees, I cannot agree. On the other hand, if the mechanism is abolished, employers will have to provide extra protection and double benefits to employees. And it is similar to moving goalposts, and it will deal a great blow to the business sector. I don't have any comment on enhancing the employees' benefits and rights, but the plight of the SMEs should not be ignored. If the business sector is being robbed and being taken advantage of so as to ensure that their rights are protected, then I object to that. The Liberal Party and myself, of course, support Mr. Ng's amendment, but I need to add a footnote here. Well, it seems that he is suggesting the mechanism is operating very smoothly, but I beg to differ, because over the past decade since introduction of the MPF scheme, I have been objecting to the system, because we're talking about billions of dollars over the past years. If I remember correctly, the administration costs over the years amounted to some $50 or $60 billion. So the to target the problem at source, the government should conduct a comprehensive review of the MPF scheme. Well, just now, it is suggested that upon retirement, employees should be able to live a dignified life, and then the offsetting mechanism should be abolished. But over the decades, my parents' generation, including our generation, have been relying on our own savings. We do not rely on the contribution from our children. The MPF system itself cannot really guarantee that all employees can live a dignified life on retirement. Because frankly, after the offsetting mechanism is abolished, employees still cannot rely on the MPF benefits to lead a dignified retirement life. I so submit. Mr. Pun Siu-peng. Mr. President, I need to declare, first of all, that I am a non-executive director of the MPF authority. It is a voluntary duty, no interest is involved. And I am speaking on behalf of the labor sector. I want to take the government and this chief executive to task. I support Mr. Wong Kwok-kin's motion. The MPF offsetting mechanism is obviously a flaw because it undermines the MPF's function as a form of retirement protection. It also eats into the employees' rights and interests. The chief executive should honor his promise to abolish the offsetting mechanism. Because, as we all know, because of the offsetting mechanism, employees are at present unable to obtain in full their severance payments and long service payments. According to the MPFA report, the administrative costs have been on the rise. In 2015, there were 45,300 offsetting cases. Up by 4% comparing to the previous year, and the amount totaled $3.31 billion, up by $348 million. Well, on average, each case involved over $70,000. Mr. President, these are not just figures. These are the hard-earned money and the compensation that an employee is entitled for the hard labor that they have given. However, the MPF contributions are used to offset the SP and LSPs, and this gravely undermines the MPF's function of retirement protection. In the chief executive's manifesto, he categorically said that progressively, the accrued benefits derived from employers' MPF contributions to offset the long service payments will gradually be abolished. However, it's been 4 years since the chief executive has assumed office, and so far there has been no progress. There is just a consultation on the policy direction in this regard, and I find this regrettable. Our federation has been asking for the expeditious abolition of the MPF offsetting mechanism. We do not believe that the unemployment subsidy should be used to offset the SP and LSP. In February, according to a report, the subsidy seeks to relieve the pressure of the unemployed in the short term, and also to provide compensation to employees when they are sacked. And they don't carry any element of retirement protection. The government is mixing the two together, and it doesn't help to address the issue. Apart from the employers in the labor sector, the government is also responsible for tackling this long-standing issue. In relation to the unemployed assistance, well, the labor sector has been urging the government to set up a mechanism. Since 2001, we have been urging the government to set up a loan fund for the unemployed, so that instant relief can be provided to the unemployed on a one-off basis in the short term, so as to relieve their financial burden because of unemployment. And at the same time, the government would not need to have a huge financial burden on the short, on the long, in the long term. We believe that these two matters are separate. Next year in April, the default investment strategy, so-called the core fund, would be introduced. This initiative seeks to lower administrative costs and offer an additional choice for employees who are not familiar with investments. I welcome this change, but this is far short of really helping the society. For example, MPF cannot help protect those not in the workforce, such as housewives. I urge that MPF accounts also be set up for this group of people, and the government should be responsible for making contributions to their accounts as employers. I want to emphasize, Mr. President, that the offsetting mechanism is a flaw to the MPF scheme and it must be abolished. The chief executive should honor its pledge, and the government also has a role to play. The government is responsible for protecting employees' rights and interests. Resources should be allocated appropriately to resolve this issue of MPF offsetting. I so submit.
Dr. Ching Chung Tai. Thank you, President. I'd like to state my position. I think the MPF system has to be abolished. And the government has to shoulder the responsibility to plan for the future for the members of the public and the retirement protection. That's the ultimate solution to the problem. Over the past decade or so, since its implementation, the MPF has come in for so many criticisms, in particular lack of transparency regarding the management fees. The government sought to amend the legislation to assuage public concerns, but the more they try to amend the legislation, the more they show up the loopholes to such an extent that we need to abolish it altogether. In 2012, for example, there was a semi-portable scheme for the choices. But as a result, we saw that the amendments failed to achieve the desired effect. At the beginning of this year, it was reported that between 2015 and 16, in terms of MPF, the losses were as much as a minus 8%. Each worker stands to lose something like $20,000 in their contribution. If the amendments were effective, why is it the statistics are telling us that our hard-earned money not only is unable to enable people to fend for themselves in retirement, but 7 million people's hard-earned money is invested in a capitalist market, but the fund houses are chipping away at our retirement protection, and they are gambling away a lot of our money without the workers being aware of it. Now, the motion was moved by Mr. Wong Kwok-kin, and this motion is in response to the offsetting arrangement. But this subject is a non-issue. This subject is a pseudo-subject. MPF should not contain any element of LSP and SP as part of the offsetting arrangement. We are facing the exploitation by the large corporations and the developers, and they have to fork out tremendous rents. And if they fail in the business, they should be held responsible, and the businessmen have to express their dissatisfaction with the administration. They should not extort the workers. So LSP and SP should not be part of the offsetting arrangement for the employers to pull a fast one. So for the above reasons, the MPF fails to achieve the purpose of becoming a retirement protection scheme, and the offsetting arrangement is impractical, because that's the reason why we have to abolish the MPF altogether. The MPF system not only fails to protect the working population, the effect of an MPF is the loss of the hard-earned money for the workers, and the MPF fails to protect the housewives, and they're only relying on the breadwinner, and also under the MPF, the fund houses, insurance companies are gambling away our money. All the statistics are telling us that MPF fails as a retirement protection, and it fails to improve our lot in our day-to-day life. For these reasons, now this is a non-binding motion. My position is to rid ourselves of the MPF. So I'm not going to vote in this motion. And I hope that you would understand all the problems concerned. Well, Dr. Cheng, you mentioned Wong Kwok-kin. This is a motion moved by Ms. Wong Kwok-kin, not Ms. Wong Kwok-kin, who is a former legislative member. Mr. Jeremy Tam. Fellow councillors, I speak in support of the abolition of the MPF offsetting mechanism. The idea of MPF is to enable the workers to have some money for retirement. This is one of the five pillars advocated by the World Bank. Unfortunately, since its implementation 15 years ago, there is a baffling arrangement whereby the of the SB and LSB can be offset by the MPF contributions. And $26 billion has been leaked as a result. 67% of the MPF was leaked under the offsetting arrangement. When we consider whether we should abolish the offsetting arrangement, I think we have to come back to the design of the long service payment and severance payment. Back in 1995, when the bill was being scrutinized, Mr. Lee Chuck Yan elaborated on the issue in sufficient detail. The idea of severance payment is to make sure that those who got sacked would have a sum of money to tie them over. The long service payment is intended to make sure that those with long service will not end up with nothing when they get sacked. So basically, the long service payment and severance payment are there to minimize the hardship caused to the workers when they lose their job. The MPF, on the other hand, emphasizes on retirement protection. So MPF must be distinguished from the MPF and LSP, at the SP and LSP, and they serve different purposes. If you offset them one against the other, then it is an incongruous arrangement. The protection would be eroded. The arrangement of allowing offsetting to take place is an erroneous policy, and it was a policy that sold the workers down the river. The offsetting arrangement, it was claimed, that has been serving us well. That has been serving us well. I mean, does it mean it is correct? This is a deceitful lie. And offsetting arrangement involves the private fund, the provident fund. If we replicate the arrangement from the private fund into the MPF, then it's not appropriate. The government did so for one single purpose, and there was a bit of horse trading with the business community. The government sold the rights of the workers to the employers, and they implemented this offsetting arrangement. It was an option that was foisted down the throat of the workers. The government merely bullied the workers, but cave in to the pressure of the employers. Many members try to hold CY loan to the promises of removing the offsetting arrangement. I think it is time for the government to honor their pledges. even if we get this off the ground, this is not any benefits from CYLL because it was wrong in the first place. Back in 1995, it was promised that an offsetting arrangement would be subject to review 20 years on. The review is still going on. I hope that others speaking for the business community would think twice. They should not keep saying that by removing the offsetting arrangement, the employers will have to pay twice, and they feel aggrieved. Now, it begs the question, why doesn't the employer have to pay twice? Because we're talking about two different protection altogether. Why do you have to eat lunch and dinner, and you have dinner after lunch? The contribution, if the contribution from the employers are for SP and LSP, why doesn't the government make the employers set up a different account? Why do they allow them to have an offsetting arrangement and pretend as if they care about the workers? There are some members who said that the offsetting arrangement has been working fine. I doubt why they say so. I think members from different political persuasions pointed out that there are problems with offsetting arrangement. I noticed that some members suggested that the retirement scheme should be linked with an insurance plan, that the government should pick up the premium. I think this can be discussed, but unfortunately those members who advocated this failed to give us in-depth details about the contribution that's going to be incurred. So members, I think we have to ask ourselves, the workers have been toiling hard all their life. By the time they retire, they only get only 5% of their contribution in their account. So I support Ms. Lau Siu-lai, Mr. Wan, and Mr. Jones' amendments. Thank you.
Oi.
Mr. Nathan Law, fellow councillors, we have been debating the issue of MPF offsetting mechanism in this council. In 2005, a motion was moved by Mr. WONG Kwok-kin. In 2011, another motion moved by Mr. Tam Yu-chung, both urging for the abolition of the MPF offsetting mechanism. The motions were endorsed, and yet the relevant report did not say a word about this idea, and there has been no progress. Now, in recent months, when CY Leung wants to run for another term, he begins to reach out to different groups and begin to float this idea again. And yet, the proposal is to replace SP and LSP with an unemployment insurance fund. Now, according to this year's report, the poverty population is on the rise. And yet, the government's solution to this problem is to abolish the assistance. Now, there are suggestions that this council is completely useless because no relief measures can be introduced. And we think that we are responsible, but the government should also be responsible, because even if we have similar motions debated in this council again and again, no matter how many motions are carried in this council, the government can just disregard the motions. We have three kinds of labor rights with different objectives. Now, for retirement protection, it seeks to give protection to elderly on their retirement. For occupational or for the employment protection fund, it seeks to protect employees from arbitrary dismissal. When an employer dismisses an employee, but there is no extra cost, and this is in fact undermining the employee's interest. And under the offsetting mechanism, employees' contribution will also be used to offset the payments. And again, the employee's interest is undermined. According to the LegCo report, the median age of employees involved in the offsetting mechanism is 50 years old, and the average amount is 7,100. For those earning this amount, well, they their payments are being offset, and they are unable to maintain their living expenses after retirement. In 2015, there were 1,100 cases, and this is just a very humble and modest request to abolish the MPF offsetting mechanism so as to protect the grassroots workers' interests. Since 1997, GDP has been on the rise. The Gini coefficient also increased at the same time from 0.47 to 0.53. Even for fresh graduates, the starting point of the salaries dropped by 17%. Hong Kong has a very serious problem of wealth gap. So offsetting LSPs and SPs with MPF contribution is really absurd, because the problem comes not from the labor sector, but from the economic environment as a whole. If the cost is shifted onto the labor sector, it shows how incompassionate our society is. And according to the LegCo Secretariat's study, there is no similar arrangement around the world which is as mean as the one we have in Hong Kong. Every time when we debate on the MPF offsetting mechanism, as other members mentioned just now, the business sector always adhere to this tune. That is, 1995. In 1995, there was a consultation and a consensus was reached. The government traded with the business sector in order to win their support. That was when the MPF ordinance was passed. It's been it's 2016 now. It's been 20 years, and yet the grassroots workers do not enjoy the fruit of our economic success. Well, in the face of labor issues and poverty issues, must we follow the old practices? Must we not review our existing arrangement? Can we still put up with the fact that labor rights are being ignored whilst our economy thrives? I think that this is totally unacceptable. Mr. Jimmy Ng, representing the industrial sector too, I oppose his amendment. He claims that the MPF scheme is operating very well, and the offsetting mechanism saved $29.2 billion. But we must bear in mind that the $29.2 billion is a result of the labor's effort, and they're entitled to the long service payment and severance payment. So we're talking about the hard-earned money of our workers here. It is really a constitutional catastrophe for his motion to be passed. Well, also we have Mr. Andrew Wen and Mr. Lau Siu-lai's, Ms. Lau Siu-lai's amendment. The chief executive made his pledge in a manifesto. Over the past 5 years, no study was conducted. Even FTU is taking the chief executive to task, and it is totally unacceptable to give a perfunctory proposal instead. The government always says that the elderly issue should be addressed, but it hasn't only to do with elderly. We need more social protection and retirement protection. So we ask for universal retirement protection, and the 2064 proposal should be implemented so that the lower and middle class workers can make use of their MPF accrued benefits. Mr. Alvin Yeo, thank you, Mr. President. On behalf of the Civic Party, I support Mr. Wong Kwok-kin's motion to abolish the MPF offsetting mechanism. All along, our party has been objecting to the offsetting of severance payments and long service payments by accrued benefits of the in the MPF accounts. Now the offsetting mechanism is used to protect employers' interests instead of employees' interests, which is the objective of the MPF scheme. Now the MPF contributions have become the SP and LSP to be paid by employers, except in special circumstances, employees are not allowed to withdraw their MPF contributions, and yet special privileges are given to employers such that the employers' contributions can be used to offset SPs and LSPs. So in a way, the MPF scheme is a kind of severance payment fund for employers. As mentioned by other members, the MPF scheme was introduced 15 years ago, and we also have $28.2 billion used in the offsetting mechanism. In fact, in the report submitted to the Commission of Poverty, in 2015, in the offsetting cases, the amount accounts for 51% of the accrued benefits in or 93% of employers' contributions. What does it mean? It means that almost all of the employers' contributions were used to offset the payments. So what is the responsibility of employers, and how much protection is left for our employees? We're not a welfare society, and we have not been offering much protection to grassroots workers anyway. And it is really detrimental to grassroots workers' interests. And the offsetting mechanism will further erode the compensation which employees are entitled. For example, where there may be unscrupulous employers who would dismiss employees again and again, and there may be even a greater impact for older employees, because when they retire, there will not be much left in the MPF account. And the offsetting mechanism, in a way, also indicates how it is necessary to abolish the functional constituencies in this council. Because back then, to gain the support of the functional constituencies, the government in the end allowed this offsetting mechanism to be in place. And apart from the business sector and the FC members, the FTU members should also be responsible, because in the end, in the negotiation process, the FTU agreed to this arrangement, and this is the crux of the problem. And that is why the government all along is still unwilling to abolish the offsetting mechanism. Now, we must oppose Mr. Jimmy Ng's motion, because his amendment states that the MPF offsetting mechanism has been operating effectively. And I think he's only speaking from the employee's perspective. And he's not really in touch with society. For the general public, especially for employees in Hong Kong who are subject to the offsetting mechanism, they cannot feel how effective and smooth the operation of the MPF system is. If we abolish the offsetting mechanism, would it really exert huge pressure on the business sector? Professor Wong Yu-Jim in Hong Kong University already stated that, in fact, the cost is shifted onto the employees in the offsetting process. But in fact, it should be the employer's responsibility to provide for these payments, and they should not be given an excuse not to pay. Mr. President, we also oppose Dr. Zheng Lai-wan's motion, because we believe that it is the employer's responsibility to make the payments instead of the taxpayer or the government. As for Mr. Michael Tian's amendment, we cannot support his amendment because we also believe that MPF should provide protection to employees, and it is the employer's responsibility to pay SP and LSPs. As mentioned by other members just now, the incumbent chief executive, Siu-lai in 2012, during the election, mentioned that he would progressively reduce the ratio of using the employer's MPF contributions to offset SPs and LSPs. Unfortunately, there's only slightly more than 1 year till the end of his term, and we still can't see how he can honor his pledge. And we are very dissatisfied, and we'd like to reprimand the chief executive for not making any progress at all. And I'd like to remind members representing the business sector here, I don't think our business sector is this selfish, and I don't think our business sector would just hide behind the offsetting mechanism and shun their responsibility. I believe that the offsetting mechanism is equally unfair to many practitioners in the business sector. They, of course, can exercise their rights, but at the same time, they should shoulder their corporate social responsibility. I hope the government would heed my view, and I also hope that the business sector can display their conscience. I so submit.
Thank you.
Mr. Frankie Yick, President, the aim